I think I want to just tell you how I feel first by reading the scripture that the Lord laid on my heart. You know, because I looked at, you had all these thoughts about what happened over the weekend, and there was a lot of powerful things that happened. But really, you know, if you zoom out on God's level, right? If you just zoom out on God's level, everything will fail. There's only one thing that will never fail. And it's like church, I had this, I don't know if it's a vision that I manufactured with my own thoughts, like Papa said one time, you know, it's you must have had one of them pizza dreams type of deal, right? But like I saw this, like I was thinking about, you know, church and just church proceedings in general and just the whole like ecosystem of Christianity. I'm not being negative. I want you to hear my heart. And it's like there's this giant for sale sign and a help wanted sign on the window at the same time. Because the days of like regular church, they're gasping. And we're trying to, as a people, because that's all we know. Like when I got saved, what happened to me was my first confession out of my mouth was, take me to a Catholic church, please, quickly. Like if I had something wrong with my limbs, you understand what I'm saying? Spiritually speaking, I just said, take me to the Catholic church. Why? Because somebody like Brother Steve would say, I mean, this is years ago, he preached this. Look, that's the information that I had. That is the seed that was planted in my life, right? That have produced, you know, whatever it is. It formed my soul in a way where that is what was the confession, you know. And God used that. He did. He used it, and we don't need to go through that again. But ultimately, God really wants to get really super close with us. Like really close. And the study that I already knew this, God's been churning this in my spirit for a while, the book of Job. And but I didn't really get like a clear path, and I didn't want to get into this whole like, oh, the Lord showed me where we're going, right? Like you know what it is? Like I just want to talk. Right? Like I want us to get really real with what God's doing in our lives. Like not worrying about who goes to church where, right? Because that's cyclical stuff. That's cyclical. It happens. Like there'll be a people that abide together. We need that. I pray that God would strengthen the core in this house that we would abide through all things. But I understand this too. Like the boys that Jesus walked with, they were pretty tight. Right? And then we read in the Acts, you know, there's all kinds of stuff that happens. Jesus says, are you going to leave me too?
Yeah.
Right? And they probably thought about it and they realized, well, I guess our idea of church has been turned upside down. We got nowhere to go, though. Right? I mean, I'm paraphrasing. You see, I'm feeling through that word, but that's kind of what they said. And then he jacked it up to another level. Right? When he got himself in trouble. Because then, like, well, all bets are off now. We just wasted our life. I can't even go back to doing my job. Although they did find employment later, didn't they? They went back to doing what they were doing before, and he had to fish them out. They were fishing, he fished them out. But ultimately, like, we live our lives and we cohabit this place, and God wants to be in our midst. Like, really wants to get to know us. He really wants to have fellowship with people. Like, why are you going to, like, why are you going to church? What do you want? You want a good message? We can have a good message. It's not going to do you any good when all of it hits the fan. Because look, I've said this before, this is not going to make it. It's going to die one way or the other, whether I have spent my life feeling great about my life, or whether or not I went to church every Sunday to feel good about my repenting, like Brother Merv would say. Right? It doesn't matter. It's all of that stuff is games in the mind. Right? But God has a passion for a people. He wants to have a relationship with the people. Right? And man and religion will constantly tell man that you cannot have that closer relationship with God. What did you say, Sister Byrne? Because are you in my heart or are you in my notes? Because that's exactly what's going on. Right? And like, so we're going in, I want to do Job, right? And like, I had this thought. I had this thought about this study. It was like I was standing on a cliff, like in awe, right? Like when you're about to jump, do something crazy, like jump and dive from like 40 feet or something onto the ocean, or just parachute jump or something like that, something crazy where you're like, whew, all right, I'm about to do this, right? Like, I don't have all the answers. I have no idea how this is going to go. Right? But I can tell you this, like Philemon, watch this. This is what he said, Brother Paul said about Philemon. He said, I thank my God, making mention of you always in my prayers, hearing of your love and faith, which you have toward the Lord Jesus and towards all saints, that the communication of your faith may become effectual by the acknowledging of every good thing which is in you in Christ Jesus. For we have great joy and consolation in thy love, because the bowels of the saints are refreshed by you, brother. I just want to be that guy. Is that okay? Like that, because you know why? Like, I could preach the greatest message of all time. No, I won't. But like I say, like if I could, okay? Like I was joking around with, I don't even remember what I was talking to. Like, listening to Brother Steve is like listening to God. All right? But the point is, all of those things have an end. God's going to get after the heart. There's going to be a people that are going to be right there with him in the inner circle. Right? What's the price of admission? Right? Come on. What is it? Everything. Yeah, and if you listen to Job, it's everything and then some. We'll find out about that, because you really cranked it up. What did you tell me, Mimi? God picked me out to pick on me? Yeah. Now, my flesh will say that sucks, but my spirit's like, oh.
There it is. That's what keeps you going.
Right? So, Job it is then. All right, and I'm not really sure where to start. I think really the book of Job, you know, I'm going to lean a little bit on the book by Brother Varner. Maybe not lean, I'm not sure how, I don't know what's going to happen. Because I'll tell you why, too, because you know what the book of Job is all about for me? It's really this simple. Like, we can talk about it. It's a book of suffering and how man really needs to get it together. Like, when I was a boy, I remember two things. My grandfather made me read the Bible. I only remember two stories: the book of Job and the Tower of Babel. They were one of them picture things, right? But I got it. This is what I got out of the book of Job. Don't argue with God, right? And that's a good message for kindergarten. But here's what really, this is what it is to me, this book of Job is so weird. This is what it's really about. It's like, how much God do you really think you can have? That's what it is to me. How much God do you think a man can have? How much God can you have in your life? And everyone in the book tried to talk Job out of it. And in the end, see, I believe, this is what I believe. I don't want to get too far ahead, but I believe Job was just about to open his mouth again after Elihu had his turn. And then God just kind of like, oh, I'll take it from here. But we are not going to get there probably until 2024. So I'm joking. All right. I'm joking. I know. This is what I'm saying. Like, I'm not sure how this is going to go. I want us to be effectual, right? Like, that word, what is it? That the communication of your faith, that word communication is literally fellowship.
Yep.
This is Christ life fellowship. I want our fellowship to be effectual. It's not going to be effectual unto the attainment of what God wants in Christ Jesus if it's just religious stuff. Like, if it's just church and this is how we got to do church and we got to make sure all the church problems are sorted, like, that's not going to work, right? Like, we don't need folks. A mature people will not need anybody to explain to them what it's like to be a family. Like, I looked at my kids. I love my kids. And I teach them. I correct them. I spend time with them. I father them. Right? I do all those things. And I know what you're going to tell me. Oh, you'll never stop worrying about your kids. Listen. I may not ever stop enjoying my kids. But I know for a fact, because I believe God, there is going to be a time where I can go out with my wife for dinner and not worry about who my kids are being babysat by. Can you relate with that? But that's church, right? Like, church. Like, everybody wants to argue about what we talk about in church or how church works, and here's what your church is doing wrong. Fine, go ahead. You know what? Why don't you fix it? Or whatever else you got to say about it, the bottom line is that's still carnal, like Paul called it. Oh, I'm of this, I'm of that. Have you considered this doctrine? Have you considered this method? Well, we should be doing more of this. We should stop doing this. We should be definitely doing this. This is why you're having a problem, because you're not doing this. And I'm really skipping ahead here with Job. But the reality is, God really wants to have communication that's effectual amongst the brethren. A mature communication. Right? Oh, I'm so tempted to just like put my toe right into Brother Danny's stuff. Right? And then go through all the stuff that happened on the weekend. But it's okay. It's already happened. God's moving in God's people. He's moving. He's working. Effectual. Because, like, real. And that's what this book of Job is, and I want to start by, and this is probably all we're going to do tonight, just like a quick primer, quick introduction into like the spirit of this book, right? And like, let me just show you a couple of things that the brother me he has some Brother Varner has some quotations about folks explaining the book. What I think is really cool about the book, like, there's really no way to know when it was written. I mean, people have ideas, right? It was really old, that maybe Moses wrote it. And, you know, and I asked the Lord, and I said, Lord, don't answer if you don't want to, because I really don't care. I want to focus on the theme and the subject and what's going on. But, like, I've considered who actually wrote it. And I've allowed myself to even entertain the thought, maybe an angel wrote it. Yeah, that's true. But, you know, we're so religious and we're so afraid. We're focused on, like, I don't know. In aviation, there's this saying, it's not the plane, it's the pilot, right? And we're so worried about all the things God wrote that we just forget to worry about God himself, the Father. You know, you ever heard about, you know, Papa always said, right, like, the Bible really... ultimately can't contain all of him, right? That's why we have to have faith. He'll never violate, like, this is the cool thing, this is the prism, like he'll never violate the word. That's why it's like a paradox. He'll never violate. He'll never violate it. You do not need to add a single word to this thing. Right? In fact, he's so sure of it that he had a person walk it out. Right? And then people will finish it. Right? But like, I've thought about like who actually wrote it, because there were things, there's over the years what you would call like extra biblical material. There's a lot of that stuff, right? You can get into and really, you know, wind up on some kind of trail that's really not going to do your soul or your spirit any good at all. Might make you a little bit smarter, might give you some weird information. It might even be accurate, but it's distracting ultimately. Right, but I thought about it. I said, you know what, maybe, Lord, maybe you made Elihu write this book. I don't know. It's possible. Maybe an angel wrote it. I don't know. Maybe one of the guys that presented themselves, one of the sons of God wrote it. Can't be sure. Can't be sure. People don't know. Maybe Moses wrote it when he was in Midian. It's possible, right? Some of the dates, some of the hints, they all make sense. So I think, again, when we have a situation where it's hard to know exactly what's going on, that's where usually you can find God. Right, because it's outside of intellect, it's outside of those things that will entertain the human flesh, right? Us humans love to engage in. We love to be sure. We just love to be sure. Amen. And God's constantly calling a people higher because we have not experienced all of God yet. Like, think about it. We talked about it in being a temple of the Holy Spirit study, right? Adam and the woman, right? Lost something. So why are you naked? Well, who told you were naked? Right? So they were clothed with a measure of glory. They lost that. But it wasn't the glory that Jesus had. It wasn't Jesus. And then we have the glory on Mount Transfiguration. Right? And then we have the prayer, Lord, glorify me with the glory I had with you before the world was. So in 1 Corinthians 15, we know that there are varying degrees of resurrection, right? In Hebrews, we know that some folks who died, who walked the walk and died in faith, they did so clinging to the hope of a better resurrection, right? So there are things, like Brother Varney used to say it this way, school's not out yet. Right? We still have a lot to hear from the Lord. And so, like, and what we do as people, and especially us smart people that get smart, like, we're like, oh, no, there's got to be an answer. Let me just study it out. Not understanding that unless the Lord reveals it, the Lord has to reveal it. He has to quicken our hearts to understand. And, like, maybe he hasn't quickened all things for us to understand because maybe we're not ready to drive the car yet. I don't know. I'm just speaking as a man, but I'm just saying there's more to God than going back to what we used to know before. And through all of that, there's all this stuff that works in our lives, on our emotions, and our physical experience that will constantly try to distract us. Constantly try to distract us so we don't claim the prize. Constantly. Right? And so consider just some of the ways this book is, just some comments about the book. The book of Job is perhaps the greatest masterpiece of the human mind. I'm not sure who these people are, but that's okay. Victor, maybe some of you know. Victor Hugo said that. I call this book, apart from all theories about it, one of the grandest things ever written. Our first, oldest statement of the never-ending problem, man's destiny and God's way with him in the earth. There is nothing written, I think, of equal literary merit. Thomas Carlyle. He probably didn't read The Lord of the Rings, but maybe he did, I don't know. But I think that's equal in literally. No, I'm just joking. I just happen to like that book too. But actually, for the fans of Lord of the Rings, it's quite similar in some elements, right? There are elements in The Lord of the Rings that blow your mind because it takes you outside, right? The book is very comfortable with infinity, right? Right? It doesn't define the world. It introduces it, right? And God is constantly calling a people higher, right? So this book of Job, again, is this transcending account of this man, and God picked on this man. And we're going to look into that. Why did he do that? What did God want? And here's the cool question for me, and I think it's for all of us. What did Job want? What was his voice in this whole thing? What was he after? Because what I see in the book and all the times that I've read it, and like I said, when God began to deal in my life, the book of Job was immediately where I went. Because I said, I don't care where, all I could remember was that kid book that my grandfather was showing me and made me read and explain to him what I read about. And that's all I could remember is the book of Job. And I said, I'm not going to argue with you. And I sat there and I was crying, Lord, I wish this was true, right? That was how God was dealing with me. But I see this book of, all of the stuff that happens in the book is really ultimately leads up to the point where it's just God and Job face to face and they understand each other. There is no fear. There is no Lord, but what about this? There is no devil. And he's also a priest to his friends. But the point is, it's face to face. No more problems. Just peace. But it's just about God and man. Right? The book of Job rises like a pyramid in history of literature and is without predecessor and without rival. That's Philip Schaff. Job is the Melchizedek among the Old Testament books. Job is the clear and ambiguous voice of humanity, which finds echo in all of the world. Job is the greatest poem in literature, whether modern or ancient. Job is a magnificent and sublime, more than any other book in the scriptures. That's Martin Luther. That's what he said. So I just think that's kind of like just to set the tone, right, for what we're dealing with. And so like for me to stand here and to pretend that I'm going to somehow exegete the book of Job, right, to use that fancy word that we hear sometimes, that's probably not going to happen. But remember what I want to be, I want to be Philemon, I want to be effectual, right? Like I don't want you to have a message. You're like, oh, that was a good message. I will apply this message in my life. No. For people to really get it, for people to really make a difference in the earth, right, it has to penetrate our hearts to a point where it begins to flow out. It begins to flow out, begins to change our walk. Because that will go beyond whatever mistakes we make, whatever, like, let's say our messages that we preach, maybe they need to be corrected ultimately. All of that will happen, right? Because we prophesy in part, we know in part, right? There's people that are going to come, right? And we'll grow with those people. And maybe someday they'll leave, I don't know, right? But ultimately, if we're effectual in the Spirit, it's the only way. God will have his way. He will have a people. He establishes things in the earth. He does it. Right? And then he can destroy it all and he can establish it again. No, he can't. Yeah, he can. He can do whatever he wants. That's the thing. That's the whole thing here. And I want to get to that a little bit. I have time. I do. But this is, so we'll start with the common thing, right? It's the book of human suffering. So let's consider the suffering. Like I was talking to Brother Dale, I had a chance to very briefly hang out with him on Monday night. I don't even remember when he said it, whether he said it on Monday night or Tuesday morning, I don't remember. It all kind of blends in now. But we were talking about how Paul's conversion, where the Lord said to him, he said, I'm going to show him all the things that he will have to suffer for my name. And we talked about, oh, he's suffering because of all the things he did. No. He's going to show him all the things that he's going to suffer for his name. He doesn't care about, like, God's like, no, I'm going to use that. And then we spend our life looking back behind, in the rearview mirror. All the stuff, the good and the bad that happened. But God's taking a people and he's going to put them through a process. So on the other side is just God and man, a corporate man. And there's just praise. It's a wholesome confession. It's just praise. It's just, Lord, you are good. It's not like, hey, I have a question for you, Lord. Or like when we're talking about, when Brother Dale was talking about Joseph, right? It's not fair, Lord. When are you ever going to take care of that? Whether you take care of it or not, you won't care. Like a different dimension, a better resurrection, that I might know him. Right? You know that? This is all I wanted to do. Nikita, you just got to do it instead of talking about it. So let me read it. I hope it's all right. We're just hanging out, right? Yea, doubtless, I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ and be found in him, not having my own righteousness which is of the law, but that which is through faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I might know him in the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Not as though I have already attained, either we're already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto the things which are before. I press, what's before? I press towards the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. And here's what, again, back to Job real quick. This is what I hear from Job's heart. This is the whole thing for me and Job. Everybody's trying to tell him, no, just God is not interested in you. Like, just follow the protocol, Job. No, I want something outside of protocol. Well, who are you? I don't care. He made me. I'm going to ask a question. He calls himself a father, so I'm going to ask him. Do you understand what I'm saying? Like, no. That's what everyone tried to talk Job out of. No, follow the rules, Job. Get in your lane. Here's the law, Job. He said, I want to talk to him. Well, who do you think you are? I don't care. I don't care if he kills me. I want to talk to him. Who do you think you are? That's what I'm trying to find out. Let us therefore, as many as be perfect, be thus minded. If anything, you be otherwise minded. Right? That's helpful. That's a helpful tone. God shall reveal even that to you. So don't be in such a hurry. Don't get frustrated. Right? Nevertheless, here he is. Let him finish this thought. Whereunto we have already attained, let us walk by the same rule. Let us mind the same thing. Brethren, be ye followers together of me, and mark them which walk so, as you have us for an example. For many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is their shame, who mind earthly things. For our citizenship, or conversation, is in heaven, from whence also we look for a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our vile body, that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body, according to the working whereby he is able to even to subdue all things unto himself. Well, he's able. He's doing it. But you know what? In the midst of it all, there's so much confusion in the world. There's so much confusion in God's house, right? And God is after a clean confession. He's after a wholesome tongue, a song, right? Like what Brother Danny did with us, that was awesome. With the harmony, like Dawah School, and that's just not even, I don't even know if that's barely a tithe of the spiritual implication of what God's really trying to pull out of a people. Mm-hmm. Right? But it's a cool illustration nevertheless. So, I said all that to read a little bit out of Job. And this is going to be fun, right? Because this is going to be cool. Like, we're going to actually follow Job. I'm just going to read it. If there are things I don't understand or things that God doesn't lay on my heart, I hope that he lays it on yours. But the point is, let's observe this. Let's observe this case. And let it be effectual into to our hearts. I'm not here to wow anybody, right? I just want to be effectual. Because I want to live, I want to be close to God, and I don't want to be alone. It's my biggest fear. I don't want to be alone. And God comforted me about that. You heard me say it before. You don't have to be. I was alone for everybody. And the proof of that, scripture and verse, I love when Paul said, they all left me. We had a good church. These guys were great. They were all strong. But then he said, they all left me. Yeah. But then he added something that I love. But Luke is with me. Ooh. It's good to me. I can't find Job. I have it. Oh, God, help us. Hallelujah. There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job, and that man was perfect and upright, and one that feared God and eschewed evil. You got a little picture of this guy, right? So this is an account of this guy. And there were born unto him 7 sons and 3 daughters. Let's unpack that very quickly. I meditated on this. So I had this guy do work on my house, and he told me, he gave me this clue, right? Baby, close your ears. Don't listen to this. You don't want to listen to this. But he said, you know, the way you really got to do it, if you want your name to live on, you got to have 3 boys. So you got to have 3 boys, minimum 3 boys, because one of them gets killed. This is how this guy's talking. So one of them could get killed. He could get cancer or whatever. And then, but you always got to double up. So you got to, and he's just like going through this whole doctrine. I'm like, Vlad, what are you talking about? But he's like, you got to have 3, right? But I thought about that, right? But this man has 7 sons. 7, right? What is that number, right? It's the number of spiritual perfection, right? Number of spiritual completion. But there's a lot of 7s, right? The word for oath, right? When God spoke to Abraham, he swore. He 7ed himself, right? And it's a 7. It's a perfect. It's a full number, right? It speaks of something real. It really speaks of a perfect legacy, right? He had 7 sons. Everything that a father could ever want, he had it, right? He looked like Papa always wanted. He wanted, one of the things he was always after is for us to get it. Well, Job got it. His name was going to have a perfect legacy. And then he also had 3 daughters. That's cool. What is the number 3, right? We have all these tools. Like Brother Varner used to say, like, we're further along than most people are. There's people that died for us to have the food that we have. It's true. You know, I remember him talking about the computer. He's like, you know, if you're still ripping through the concordance, right, by hand, you're just working dumb, right? And I know, like, I'm way closer to Brother Danny Milliken on this than I am to Brother Varner. And Brother Varner may have had a different opinion had he been here now to see what all the technology stuff that we have to deal with, how you have to rip it away from your kids so their brains will get sucked out completely, right? He might have had a different opinion, but the point is, the information for us is there. It's a lot easier for us to study, right? And so In the book of Numbers in Scripture, one of the cool points that Brother Bollinger makes is he says, you know, three is really the first time you can have the whole picture. You can't make an object with just two lines. It's impossible. But with three, you can. So it's the third dimension. You know what that is? It's reality. The Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Right? Three dimensions. Spirit, soul, body. What does the three daughters speak of to me? Expression. He had a perfect expression. And then we see by the end of the book how God beautified it, that there was none like those girls in all the land. Glory, right? We talked about varying glories. This is what this man had. He had a perfect legacy, and he had a perfect expression. This guy was awesome. He was, oh my God, he was perfect. That's what he said. He was perfect and upright. What's the problem then, right? Let's read on. His substance also was 7,000 sheep, so we can understand, like, 1,000 is a kingdom number, right? It's a number. It's also, you can go it so many ways. You can go 10 times 100, right? 100 meaning being a, that's a full picture, right? That's the overcomer, right? It's the 30, 60, 100-fold, 100-folders. They make their bed in the morning, right? 10, perfect order. So this guy operated. Like, there was no problems. He wasn't worrying about inflation. He wasn't worrying about anything else that was going on. He was in charge, and he lived large, right? Like, this guy could sit by the campfire and could tell stories, and everybody would listen to what he had to say. This is the type of man we're talking about here. Oh, yeah, I should have just read it because that's what it says. So that this man was the greatest of all the men of the East. Pretty cool. And his sons went and feasted in their houses, every one his day, and sent and called for their three sisters to eat and to drink with them. And it was so when the days of their feasting were gone about that Job sent and sanctified them and rose up early in the morning and offered burnt offerings according to the number of them all. For Job said, it may be that my sons have sinned and cursed God in their hearts. And this did Job continually. And I love this. He was a priest. But you know what's cool about the type of priest that he was? Again, we see his heart, right? It's that next dimension operation where he's like, he wasn't doing like all the little sacraments and the rudiments. He said, I don't know. It's a faith sacrifice, right? Like, I don't really know what they did or what they didn't do. I'm not going to do this specific thing to make sure my good deeds outweigh my bad deeds. I'm going to make sure my children, okay, are honored before the Lord. He wants to honor the Lord with his sacrifice. It's not about the number of sheep. It's not about the number of times you go to church, right? It's not a number of times you say the sinner's prayer. What? Right? See, we have all these methods and systems for how to get people saved, right? But here's the deal. God doesn't just want to get us saved. He wants us to win. He's already saved our soul. He wants to win it. What's the difference? Well, we're going to do this study. Now, there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord. And guess who? Satan comes along also with them. And the Lord said to Satan, "Where'd you come from?" And Satan answered the Lord and said, "From going to and fro in the earth and from walking up and down in it." And the Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job? There is none like him in the earth, a perfect and an upright man, one that fears God and eschews evil." I'll get this. Here's the first mistake. Then Satan answered. See, the world does not believe God. We don't even need to have this book had he just listened to what God said about Job. You follow what I'm saying? Now, I like how the enemy just, he just kind of skipped over it. He goes, and the Lord and said, does Job fear God for naught, right? So it's like, hey, where'd you come from? Well, I went to and fro, seeking whom I may devour. What about Job? I skipped him, right? Because that wasn't going anywhere. And he goes, well, I'm paraphrasing. I'm silly like that. But here we go. Does Job fear God for nothing? Has not you made a hedge about him and about his house and about all that he has on every side? You have blessed the work of his hand and his substance and increased in the land. But put forth your hand now and touch all that he has, and he will curse thee to your face. Again, wasn't listening to God at all. Just didn't care. He said, this man is perfect. What about him? Lord, why are you picking on me? The sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared for the glory that nobody has ever seen. All right, the Lord said, behold, all that he has is in your power. Only upon himself put not forth your hand. So Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord. And there was a day when his sons and his daughters were eating and drinking wine in the... Well, actually, hang on. Let me mention this. So, and I think we'll stop there tonight. Okay, but let me just say this. I want us to be reminded of this. What's going on in the presence of God, right? We have the advocate with the Father, and we have the accuser. And I've said this today already a couple of times, but really, you have the sons of God that come present themselves before the Lord, right? And then you have the enemy, right? And what the enemy wants to do is present us destroyed with a breach in our confession. Right? Now, here's some scriptures for that. A wholesome tongue is a tree of life. He wants to break that in our lives. He wants to break the wholesome tongue. Yeah. He wants to break the deposit of God, the flow of God that's in our heart. He wants to break that. He's not after the drunkard. Amen. Have you considered my servant Job, who's perfect? Oh, him. A wholesome tongue is a tree of life, but perverseness therein is a breach in the spirit. That's Proverbs 15:4. In the body of his flesh, through death, right? Let's just go there, actually. It's Colossians 1. I want to do this right. It's going to be another minute before I find Colossians. All right, so let's look at this. And you that were sometime alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now he has reconciled in the body of his flesh through death to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight, if you continue in the faith grounded and settled and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel, which you have heard and which was preached to every creature which is under heaven, whereof I, Paul, am made a minister. So, difference between us and Job, right? Like, Job had a hope. We didn't just get the solution, we also got it preached to us. We know the word. We know the outcome. We know everything. We know what God's after. We have it. And this man was tried, right? But that's the deal. God ultimately wants to present, the Son wants to ultimately present us blameless, perfect. And the enemy wants to corrupt communication. He wants to break and destroy. And he doesn't want to do that to the drunkard. He wants to do that to the perfect man. I'll just end with we look at what happened to Job, right? After the Lord released Satan to do that. And like I said, we'll be on this journey. I don't know for how long, and I really don't care. I want to, like I said, what I'm really after is for us to be effectual. For us to be effectual. For us to not skip over life like everything is okay. Because as we're going to find out, this dude achieved everything. Like, he had a perfect legacy. He had a perfect expression. He had perfect substance. He was the greatest man in the East. Right? East, that's where all the wisdom comes from, right? Yeah. So he had it. He was an example. I love the book. It's weird. Has no beginning, has no end. We don't know who wrote it. There's some weird stuff in it, right? When did this meeting happen between the sons of God where Satan joined? What kind of board meeting is that? Like, see, we're all going to want to focus on all those sort of details. But the bottom line is really, what was God after? And what was Job after? Because Job was after something. See, we're so afraid to ask God for real stuff, like stuff that matters. That's it. That's it. That's it. Amen. And I really think that's it right there. I don't even want to do anything else. We won't let, like, will you let God go? Are you going to let him go? Where are you going to go if you let him go? Well, I'm not good enough. Well, God's not going to, no, no, no. It's not about good enough. That's the whole point. It's not about that. What does God want? And what do you want? What do we want? We have to ask ourselves that. What are we after? Well, God hasn't answered. He hasn't talked to me for a while. Sure. Just hang on. Lord, we thank you tonight. We pray that you help your people. Help me, God. Help us, Lord, as we go through this journey, Lord God, together. Not just the study of Job, but, Lord, in this life, God, in this zip code, in these zip codes, in this Pioneer Valley, God, that we would be effectual, Lord God, in Christ Jesus. First, towards our families, in our work, in our house, Lord God, in your church, God. Bless your people, God. Strengthen your people. Undertake for your people. You do have a hedge about us, Lord God. And Lord, when we're ready, Lord God, you open up those little valves, Lord God, to allow testings and trials, God. But you do not put us in situations that are above our measure, God. And I pray that you help us, God. Help us, Lord God. Help us see you as you really are, God. That it would just bubble up in our hearts, Lord God, and it would turn into a song. We love you, Lord God, and we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.